DEC is replacing RO support for large-scale solar farms by bringing an era of Contracts for Difference forward to 2015. What impact will this have on the industry, and what will investors have to do to keep up?
There's obviously an interaction, and even more so going forward, into the Contracts for Difference environment, whereby technologies will effectively be competing against each other on price to secure investment, which is fundamentally different to the process up to now, whereby you build your project and by and large you receive your government support. So the blocking of large-scale solar from the RO will mean that projects over 5 megawatts in size will have to go through Contracts for Difference, and the allocation process there, which is via auction for solar and other what they call established technologies.
Well, the easy 1 minute explanation is you should see your solar farm no longer as a production of electricity with an upside value which you have under the power market, but basically as a nearly fixed income asset. A good comparison would be a toll bridge. You know exactly what you're going to get for every unit which your asset will utilize. In the case of a toll bridge, that would be a car. In the case of a solar wind farm, that is a megawatt hour. You know fairly certain the amount of units that you are going to have every year, i.e. the amount of megawatt hours you produce in a year, or the amount of cars that you expect to go over your bridge. When using this kind of analogy, you can actually see who naturally would be in a good place to invest in these kind of assets in the future. So I guess that we will go from a more private equity to, in the future, more debt financed and maybe large institutional investors, like, for example, in a pension fund or an insurance fund.
The larger the budget available, the more scope for handing out contracts. Therefore, in an auction process, you're going to have less pressure on downward pricing for your bids and for other technologies' bids. So therefore, in theory, it should be better for being able to gain a contract at a reasonable price which you can deliver at. The issue which solar in particular faces for the year 2015-2016 is the imposition of the European level pricing controls on Chinese panels, which won't go away until the start of 16. So this is going to artificially inflate the cost of doing solar projects in the UK at a large scale, which is an issue which isn't faced by other technologies and crucially isn't factored into the strike prices as calculated. You've got this established pot and less established pot. The established pot includes solar PV, onshore wind, landfill gas, sewage gas. So if they do size the budget for that pot at a lower level, then obviously you're going to get much more downward pressure on bids. You'll have to bid lower to make the clearing price for each year. And that will mean that all this great work which the STA and the solar industry have been doing on things like the 10 commitments and the biodiversity work, this could be at risk as everyone is incentivized to go for purely the cheapest projects.
For this auction, there's a relatively large chance that even though government wants to have established technologies competing, there will not be so much onshore wind actually going into the CFD regime. Therefore, solar will mostly compete only with itself. However, in the next auctions, you will see more and more onshore wind being able to understand the CFD, and then competition with the other technologies will take place. So therefore, for this first auction, it is the best moment to look at the CFD, because any later auction, you will have to be able to beat onshore wind. I know that the majority of trade association actually is in favor of quarterly auctions, and I think that that is correct. In this last publication, it seems that DEC is minded to have annual auctions, only once yearly. That would create an enormous stress, not only on the industry itself, but also on planners, on DNOs, etc., because it basically means that you will have 9 months at a time to prepare yourself for the next auction, and then you're going to build it in 3 months, and then you will have, again, cliff edges which we all thought would be solved by having a CFD. You will have a very stable return per megawatt hour for 15 years, and your whole return is going to be indexed, whereas today on the RO, only your ROCs are being indexed. That means that for an investor, it is a fairly simple financial model, and that makes it a, let's say, no thrills, no upside, but also no risk investment. And a lot of these larger bodies like that to make strategic investments to have guaranteed returns over the, in their view, medium to long term. The developer has to understand what does he need to be able to offer a good blind bid in the auction. For that, you will need to know, before you put in the bid, what are going to be your costs. And the major cost factors are going to be your capital expenditures, your operational expenditures, which is maintenance and land fees to the landowner, the cost towards where your money comes from, which is either your private equity money or your debt, or a combination of both, and the cost of the PPA. That means that if I would be in the shoes of the developer, I would call my bank now, I would call my investors now, and I would call anybody who can offer a CFD PPA, which we are, and hopefully also some others will announce that. And based on that, you should be able to calculate your strike price, which is needed to make a project viable.
Out of all the renewable energy technologies which can get a strike price, solar PV has the lowest hurdle rate of return modeled. So they're already squeezed in terms of margins. There'll be further downward pressure on that in this new environment, which will make it even more difficult to get funding, especially as, unlike the RO and FITs, there's no guarantee that you can get any government support at all. So it's really, it's likely that it will be potentially harder to get funding under this new regime unless substantial changes are made.